a lot of the future of gear depends on the direction of the consumer.
Exactly.
As long as the consumer is driving everything based on price, the future of gear
Not
is
good.
terrible.
Terrible. That's right.
If we as an industry continue to nitpick about price, we're going to end up buying our gear from Walmart. Modern amplifier manufacturing, I think, is in an unusual state right now. You really kind of only see, I think, two levels of what's going on. You've got those of us that are doing the high-end product, more in the custom manufacturing side of it, no matter how we've standardized the product, and then you have the low-cost import side.
Well, from my own experience, I know that it's possible to build high-quality import stuff because when I was associated with Jet City, we built some really good stuff because we actually went to the contract manufacturers and said, "Hey, we don't want this to be the cheapest thing that you can offer us. We want it to be affordably priced, but we want value, so therefore we want thicker metal in the chassis. We want thicker copper on the circuit board."
The pro of the custom high-end build, of course, is the ability to maintain the quality, but it's becoming increasingly difficult to manufacture that way because American-made parts have gotten so expensive, and the labor and the availability of the kind of parts that we need for these products is a challenge.
There's potential from my experience that you can get a better product from China. Unfortunately, most companies do go to China for one reason and one reason only, and
Keep the
that
price
is
down.
keep the price down. And when they ask for the lowest possible price, that's exactly what they're going to get. It's not necessarily, in my opinion, going to be the best possible product, but it's going to be the lowest price. And I think that is a shortcoming to using overseas manufacturing. And I don't think it's any fault of the manufacturers in China. I think it's a fault of the American and European, for that matter, businesses that are going there and putting the demands for the cheaper product.
It's a market-driven
It's
creation.
market-driven creation. And so I think that's a drawback to that. Now, the upside is that if you're willing to spend a few more pennies, you can get a really good quality product made there that will still be a lot less expensive than making it here in America, sadly, because I'm all about pro-American products.
Right.
But unfortunately, I pay my employees living wages to live in Seattle, Washington, which is, not the cheapest city in the country to live in, nor is Houston, I imagine. And we have to pay insurance, and we've got higher overhead because we're in desirable locations. So it's expensive to build product in America, but I do think there's value in it. I think that because we have oversight over what's being done on a day-to-day basis, we can ensure better quality.
That's where I think the current state is, and that's what I think the real problem in the end of the day is you've got here and you have here, and it's very difficult to find anything in
In
between.
between, though, you're right. There's not much in between. That's right.
Obviously, especially if you've ever watched any of my Guitar Gear Tech Talk, you know that I think obviously the most critical thing, of course, is the sound of the amplifier because that's what it is you're trying to replicate.
It has to sound amazing. That's the key. It's got to sound good.
But setting that fact aside, to me, what's critical is the reliability of the amp, first and foremost. And second, I think, is the functionality. It can be the greatest sounding thing in the world, but if you can't keep it running, it's useless. So,
that it be simple to use and intuitive.
Hi, I'm Michael Soldano, and I want to introduce to you
and
the new
deliver a
product.
lot of value. So, to that end,
What I try to do is keep the controls as minimal and concise as possible. In other words,
like all Soldano amps, the controls are simple and straightforward, easy to use. We have the input jack.
And by functionality, I do not think that that means features. I personally feel like an amp, if it's set up right, you shouldn't need all the weird shaping features. Your tone controls, if they do their job, should give you the shaping features, but the functionality is important, whether it's a two channel so you have effective control over both channels, or like we do a lot with the second volume and gain.
I want to give the amp as much functionality as the player requires, but I don't want to be them daunted with a owner's manual that's this thick that they have to memorize before they can even turn the amp on and get a sound out of it.
The current state of tube manufacturing is, on a lot of hands, rather dismal. I think there's still really, really great power tubes being made by Sovtek. The 5881 has been the rock solid anchor of all of my amps for the last 25, 26 years.
Right.
Killer power tubes. Preamp tubes like 12AX7s, not so much. The stuff out there now is not so good.
You know, you're now down to essentially three factories making tubes. And in times past, we had a lot of available choices.
Yes.
Correct. And companies like JJ still made a really good product. Yep. The SCB.
Oh, I just think they were wonderful.
Oh, yeah. The Wing C factory.
Oh, great stuff.
And then you still had, you know, I've always felt good about the preamp tubes from China. In fact, I still think they're the best source for pre's. But on the power side, we've just lost the option.
Right now, the biggest problem is not that there isn't a supply, but the quality, I've just noticed it deteriorate in the last 5 years. I mean, I used to be a huge proponent of the JJ preamp tube, mm-hmm. and now I honestly can't recommend them to anybody because I've had so much bad luck just in the last year where I'm basically getting an attrition rate of about 10 to 15%, which means that basically out of every 100 tubes I buy, I'm throwing away 10 to 15 of them, which is just economic disaster.
You know, the market has not responded to alternative sources of power amplification. It's not responded to solid state or to any of the few other technologies that are out there. Digital is, of course, a terrible result, and you still have to amplify it.
The biggest problem I'm having is the noise on the heaters, and there is a short-term solution, and that is all my new designs going forward, I'm putting DC heaters in them just to get rid of, and you already do that, which is
right.
Awesome.
Yeah.
But that's how I'm going to tackle this noise problem.
Taking that discussion a little further, the dwindling tube supply has changed the way a lot of us, I think, are manufacturing, in that, I don't want to speak for you, but probably less so in your case, because there doesn't seem to be a dwindling supply of the 5881.
No, not yet.
Right. Who knows when? I mean, they're coming out of a U.S.-owned factory in Russia, so God only knows how long that'll last, right? But hopefully not long, because that's a solution that we're moving towards as well, is doing the same thing, which is the 5881, the Sovtek. But it's... as the tubes have changed and as the supply has changed, we lose more and more options. And so for us, it becomes a, what do we want to replace? Okay, the Wing C's gone. What do we want to replace it with? And then does that require that we make some modifications to the circuit or the way the amplifier is performing or responding to make sure that it doesn't change the integrity of the sound? You know, a slight difference here or there is not what we want. We want it to sound this way. So for us, we have to pay much more attention to even the tubes that we have that are still in good supply, the quality of those changes, and that means that we want to make adjustments to the product around the tube, right? Mm-hmm. It's like the motorcycle riders. I mean, you change the tires on the fast bikes, it changes the way the driver's got to handle the bike.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's exactly right. I mean, the tube is the expendable part, just like,
right.
Like you're using your analogy, like the tires are the part that wear out on the motorcycle. And so you do have to tune, as you have to tune the chassis of the bike to handle with the tires, you got to tune the amp to use the tubes. And so what you've said makes a very valid point. And I think that even I've noticed that as I've designed newer amps, since I'm using the newer available 12AX7s, I'm realizing that, hey, these tubes are inherently more noisy. So what am I going to do to help handle these noise issues? Am I going to use DC heaters? Am I going to do more shielding? Am I going to maybe cut the gain back a little bit so that I'm not amplifying so much noise?
Right.
Lowering the grid impedance to, again, lower noise. Somebody needs to do something about it. Now, the one solution that I think is really cool, but it's going to take a lot of open-mindedness on the sake of the consumer, is the Roberts retro valve. And I'm just going to shamelessly plug it right here now, because Doug Roberts is a friend of mine. He spent an inordinate number of years of his life developing this thing, and he nailed it. It's a plug-in replacement for a vacuum tube that plugs into the same socket, does everything, has the same characteristic curves and everything that the tube should have, but it has no noise. It never burns out. It's like the most perfect tube, but it's not a tube.
That's the thing that is really going to be the thing that's at issue for our market, is what's going to be that replacement.
Yes.
If it's not going to be solid state, you know, bring back the Betamax.
Right.
Yeah, the issue of the big box retailers having, for lack of a better word, some serious financial difficulties. Was it like the number there the other day, like $1 billion in debt?
That's a huge number.
I can't even fathom. I won't earn $1 billion if I aggregated all of the money I'll ever make in my life and then multiplied it by almost $1 billion. Having this problem is certainly making us, well, not so much us, because we've never embraced the big box retailers really with Diamond, but it is making people rethink that program, and it is creating some shift back to the independent.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is critical, because the independent dealer is really where you're going to find the quality help. That's where you're going to find the guy who gets to know you, who understands what your preferences are, and can give you real guidance in the purchases that you want to make. I know when I was just buying products, I had a couple of guys at a few different shops that I knew and I trusted. So when I got their recommendations or their commentary on a product, I knew that it was directed at me in a way that I could trust it. And I think that's forcing everybody to have to embrace the independent retailer again and refocus on that. I feel like people need to stop concerning themselves with price shopping. That's the biggest thing for me, and I think it's where the biggest mistake is made. There's a lot of commodities out there where there's sort of a dime a dozen. When you're shopping televisions, there's very little difference between one TV to the next. There may be some differences, but the differences are less significant. And if you want to go out and find a way to save money on it, that's great. But when you're talking about guitar-related equipment, you're really addressing something that is an expression of you. It's what's creating your art. It's what's getting what it is that you want to say out there and in the way that you want to say it. And when you're talking about expressing your feelings or your emotions or your creativity in the way that you do with a tactile instrument like the guitar, that really has to be about the right product. It's got to be about a quality product that performs the way you need it to, it sounds the way you need it to, it gives you the reliability to do your job as a musician. And those do not go hand in hand with price. When you're price shopping gear like this, the more money you save, the reality is the cheaper the piece that you're getting is.
The main thing is, well, maybe not so much the industry, because the industry includes all manufacturers, including the really large ones. But what I'd like to see in general is more support of smaller companies, such as, you know, what I do, the boutiques. I think boutique products in general have been somewhat glossed over by the large retail chains. Part of that's because they don't have the sales staff that has enough bandwidth to learn the nuances of all the boutique companies and to be able to properly represent them. Part of it, I think, is just sheer fear. It's fear of selling something that's not cookie cutter, that's not mainstream. And I think that basically that's doing a large disservice to the players, because it's not allowing
or not exposing players to the broad choice that really exists in front of them.
I think hand in hand with that goes for the consumer, I think it really is, watch what you're doing with all the online buying. If you really know it's the piece that you want and it's not available to you, that's your option. You got to buy it online. And if it's a guitar that you want, the amp that you want, and that's the only way you can find it because it's not in your market, understood. But in doing that, we need to work to support the independent dealer. Why? The independent dealer is usually the one that's going to have people who really are knowledgeable about the products. And really can advise you in the way that you need. You get a good working relationship with a guy that you trust at an independent dealer. When you're trying to acquire that particular piece of gear, you're gonna get a better result when you have somebody like that to work on. We buy online at the big box stores. All we're doing is putting the independent music stores out of business. And when you do that, where will you go to get that advice that you need? Where will you go to get your gear serviced or to get help or to get the pieces that you want to augment your rig? And if you're not doing that, we're killing our own resource there, which in the end of the day, it makes our job more difficult.
The other thing I'd like to see change, and this is from the media side, is I'd like to see the end of what I call the advertorials. In other words, editorials that really look more like advertisements, and the exclusion of those from the magazines who don't choose to advertise in the magazines. If you'll, look at any of the mags in the last 10 or 15 years, you'll notice that probably there's been no reviews of any products by Soldano Custom Amplification. And you'll also notice that there's no advertising in any of those magazines from Soldano Custom Amplification. Now, of course, you can ask which came first, the chicken or the egg, but the reality is it shouldn't matter. It's like, I shouldn't need to advertise to get a review, nor should I necessarily get reviewed if I advertise.
You know, it's funny, but one of the early things that happened when our relationship started, mine and yours, was just the concept of, hey, let's do a single buy-in for an independent dealer that allows the dealer to apportion their money across both lines, right? The sales shooting agreement, right? And that was a way for us, watching this shift happen, it was a way for us to allow the independent to up the products they carry with less concern, right? If they got to spend X number of dollars just to buy Diamond products and make them available, or X number to buy Soldano products and make them available, that can be a lot for the independent dealer, and it's a lot of risk, right?
Yeah, that is.
So I think direct answer is one of the things that we're doing about that, was working collaboratively, not just on the products together, but also on the sales side of it, is making it easier for the independent dealer to gain access to the higher end product that they may have previously felt was unreachable, right?
Agreed, yeah, it does. It certainly, that is the way to help, is to take the risk out, because I think that's the number one reason that the small mom and pop stores have always shied away from boutique products, is because they worry it's too risky, It's like, oh my God, this is a really expensive thing and it's sitting on my floor, mm-hmm. and I've got to sell it. Well, it does. You don't have to have that big of an investment if you're spreading that investment over two brands in the same order.
That's right. And, the numbers sometimes are staggering. I mean, these guys are having to pay $45,000, $55,000 to be a Fender dealer.
Right. Crazy money.
But which hurts them from a capitalization perspective. And then it's like, wow, if I've got this amount of free capital available, I can bring something else. And if I want to put it in something that's higher end and I'm worried about whether my customer base will embrace that, it makes it a very difficult decision. Mm-hmm. The sales sharing agreement and the doing the products together collaboratively was sort of our way of saying, let's make the high-end products more accessible to the independent dealer, which therefore makes them more accessible to the consumer.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, the lovely Amp of the Month Club.
Amp of the Month Club, the next shiny thing, I call it. Yeah,
right.
It's the next shiny thing.
If I had a nickel for every time I heard what's hot right now are the Schmeglerhead amps. You've never heard of John Schmeglerhead?
Right.
He's that dude that's building them in his garage and they're really badass, right?
Right.
And it's, it's got its cool point. It's got a very not cool point about it. The cool thing is I think it's great to see players embracing new things.
Oh, of course, by all means.
And there are a lot of guys out there that know what they're doing. They build a nice quality amplifier. The downside, though, is, you know, anybody can make an amp and sell 50 of them.
That's right.
And the problem is when you chase that flavor of the month product, who's going to support you when that product breaks? Because it will. And when you're talking about a guy that's been building amps in his garage for 6 months or a year, or this guy used to work at this company and now he's doing his own thing, that's all well and good for a year, maybe two if you're lucky.
Yeah.
Then you end up with a product you spent a lot of money on that broke or you're not happy with it or whatever, and then you end up having to come to guys like us or other guys to fix that amp.
Company your size or mine, you know, and like saying, I've been in business for nearly 30 years. I actually have a shop and I actually have employees and overhead and all these things, whereas a lot of these guys are literally working on their kitchen table. So they have no overhead, they have no employees, they don't pay taxes. You know, they're doing all these deals, half of them are getting paid for on PayPal, and therefore they're not even really, you know, incorporated or doing any of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so they don't have the overhead that an actual business such as ours has. And
that's,
I mean,
right.
This, and this isn't just us. This isn't just the musical instruments industry. This is everywhere.
Every business.
Every business. And when you have that overhead, you have to sell a certain quantity of units per month just to pay that overhead. Whereas if you're, like, say, if you're the random builder where it doesn't matter if you build an amp this month or not because you still got your full-time day job at Microsoft or whatever, then what's happening is that, and I'm nobody to take away from anybody pursuing their dreams. If a guy wants to design the next best amp and, you know, and have his own company, I'm all for that because after all, I did it myself, you did
Same
it yourself.
Thing.
So we can't take that away from him. But what has to be understood is that if there are so many of these, what I call, like, say, next shiny things or distractions,
mm-hmm.
and consumers are just spending their money somewhat needlessly on all of this fuzz and distraction, if their dollars are going there and they're not able to keep supporting our more established companies such as ours, we have to make changes to adapt that by either raising our prices, which now makes it harder for those guys to ever attain one of our products, or we just simply quit doing what we do, you know. And now we're, and then now we're falling into the same trap that they're kind of creating, in that now there's nobody to service our products anymore. And compared to maybe the guy who only built 10 amps and went out of business, so it's not a big deal. If somebody like me disappears, there's thousands of Soldano amps out there, which I still service a lot of those on a pretty regular basis, you know.
Yep.
And if I'm not there to service them anymore, I've done a big disservice to all those customers that supported me for all those years. See, I do get a little bit frustrated, though, when I do see a customer, because I still do a lot of repair work on non-Soldano stuff in my shop, because, you know, I've got mm-hmm. the tools and I know what, I have the knowledge, so why not? And I'd get frustrated when these guys bring me these amps and they're like, this thing broke and the guy who made it isn't around anymore and it's got this problem. And then I'm looking at it and seeing all these terrible faults that the thing had. And then I'm calling the guy up going like, well, this thing really needs a lot of attention and it's gonna cost you, you know, X, Y, Z. And the guy's like, well, I only paid this much for it. I go, well, I know, but you know, the guy didn't do it right. And if you want it right, this is what it's gonna cost you.
And then you're the asshole.
Now
told
I'm the
guy.
Jerk. Yeah, like, I'm just the messenger, but he wants to cut my head off, you know?
And
I'm trying to help him, you know?
These are the things that we've all had to learn through years of experience, you know?
Yes.
Somebody who came later in the game like me, you know, I have the benefit of seeing what a lot of guys like you had to go through originally and learn on your own, but that knowledge is out there. And if you don't already have it, you're putting these things together without it, you know, we're forced into the position of saying, I can change that and make it work again, but you're still not going to be happy with it,
right?
Because it's going to continue to have this issue, this issue, this issue.
That's right.
You know, and how do you tell a guy, because in a sense you're having to tell a guy you spent a bunch of money on something that you're not going to like, and
that
nobody
right.
wants to hear that.
So we did this amp together called the 327 SD, and it's really an awesome amp. And I gotta tell you, one of my favorite things on that amp is you look at the knobs and the numbers from 0 to 8 are in black, and then 9 and 10 are in red.
The red
which
line.
Looks red line, just like an tachometer in a race car. And I think that is the coolest thing on there.
Yeah. For me, I think there was two things that were my favorites about the amp. I love the way the aesthetic turned out. I like the hot rod vibe.
Looks so good.
But more importantly to me, I think, was the versatility of the tonal signature. I mean, there's so many different sounds.
There's a lot of sounds in that amp. That's right.
Question has been addressed, it's been asked of me before, have we seen any other manufacturers doing the same thing that we've done? And actually,
not really.
Here's my complicated answer to the question. No. I haven't really seen anybody do it before. I mean, I know there's been collaborations, but you typically see the collaboration between taking somebody who's got a high reputation and applying it to their spin on the lower cost product, where you might see, like, you know, Pininfarina, the Ferrari body design guy, you know, they would sometimes assist in the design of less expensive cars than Ferraris. You'd see it that way occasionally. I mean, I know a number of people have done that, and it's produced some cool products as a result. As far as what I consider to be theoretically competitive companies, companies operating at the same level, you know, when you'd be like Fender and Gibson designing a guitar together, it's
just, yeah,
it's so out of the realm of possibility.
Right.
And I think all of the companies have become, again, very concentric in their viewpoint, very myopic in their viewpoint, to where I think the concept of saying, let's step outside and do something with somebody else to try to produce something new is so off everybody's radar.
Yeah, I guess that's true.
It's, I think that was the interesting part about it to me, was especially working with somebody that's got a history like you, the fact that we could walk into a project like this and really look at it and not have an ego over the design and go, yeah, well, this is cool. Yeah, I like this. So let's do, why don't we try this? And not have there be that thing that gets in the middle of it that says, well, what do you mean? You don't, you know, right. Why would you not want to use my power section?
Right.
And that's, I think, where you may see the obstacle to collaborative design in the future.
I see. Yeah.
I'd love to see more of it. I'm fascinated by the melding of things. I mean, you see that same concept in different areas too. I think the probable reason for that is, in the end of the day, you can call it engineering, you can call it whatever you want, but in the end of the day, it's still art.
Yeah, true.
And you know, oftentimes you're asking artists to go, hey, why don't the two of you guys paint a picture together?
Right, yeah, I don't see that happening anytime soon. Right.
Do you think the future of gear is a bright one?
Great question. Do you think the future of gear is a bright one? And
who is the
band that did that song, My Future So
Bright?
Bright,
I gotta wear shades. Timbuk 3, man, they were awesome.
That's who it was.
Love that song.
I think you're right. I think that's the best answer, is it can be.
It can be.
A lot of the future of gear depends on the direction of the consumer.
Exactly.
As long as the consumer is driving everything based on price, the future of gear
not
is
good.
Terrible.
Terrible. That's right. It can't just keep being cost driven. I think,
right.
I said a similar thing in an interview.
You have to ask yourself the question, do you want to buy quality stuff that does what it's supposed to do well and make that investment, or are you just going to buy the flavor of the week and just keep cycling through it over and over again, never being satisfied? It's kind of like eating junk food. You just keep eating junk food because you never really get satisfied. It's always doesn't quite taste as good as it should. It never quite has the nutritional value that you want to have, so you just keep just eating way too much of it. Whereas if you sit down and have one really delicious meal prepared with really good quality ingredients with really great flavoring, and it's, and it was well cared for in its creation, you're satisfied.
That's resulting, I think, in the manufacturers trying to follow that trend, saying, well, the customers want more for less, therefore we're going to provide them what looks like more, but we're going to do that at a lower cost. And in the reality, what you're getting is a less quality piece that has more more bells and whistles on it. Those bells and whistles don't help you if that's the case.
I think if they keep tunneling down the path of just like bigger, better, faster, cheaper, it's just going to implode. So that's my feeling on it anyhow.
That is making, that's diminishing the availability of quality product on the market. So when we choose to follow that trend, which is what's happening a lot, not just in the US, but worldwide, we choose to move the whole industry in a direction that's unhelpful to us.
If the players are willing to demand better stuff of us manufacturers, we'll be happy to oblige that.
That's right.
But if all they're gonna do is nitpick me about price, go shop somewhere else.
If we as an industry continue to nitpick about price, we're gonna end up buying our gear from Walmart.
That's right. And the choices will be dismal.
And we won't have left the cool shops, you know, the places
that's
that we get to go when we go around the world or we go around the United States and we get to go see these stores where you walk in and you're like, man, that's a cool looking store.
Right.
You know? Look at all the great gear in here.
That's, you
know,
right.
Great guitars, they get good amplifier selections. You know, we will lose that. And that's, you know, we got to forget the music business is barely a business.
Right.
It's a culture more than it is a business, and the vibe of that culture is important. We're not spitting out software. We're not making widgets. It's creating, in the end of the day, it's creating art, and it's creating art that moves people emotionally, and there's a vibe that goes along with that. And if we turn it into a bazaar, you know, a Turkish bazaar kind of thing, or a bargain basement industry, we lose the cool. And you know what else, in the end of the day, what else that loses? It loses the innovators. It loses guys who step up and say, I think I can do that
right.
in a different
way.
Right,
yeah, because if you take away the incentive, then why bother? I mean, I'm not going to spend a year designing some new product if I'm not even going to be able to recover my cost on it. Why bother? I mean, I'd rather be down in my shop playing with my hot rods.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So that's the thing. I think the future for gear can be bright, but it's going to depend on the consumer.
Do you guys have anything new that you're working on?
Ask me that question.
So, Jeff, what do you think? Do we have anything new that we're going to work on?
Yes.
Yep.
Soldano Amplifiers has made a big mark in the industry, and I'm very grateful for the nearly 30 years I've been in business. I'll be celebrating my 28th anniversary in a mere month or two from now. And I've been gifted with some amazing opportunities. I've had the pleasure of working with some amazing artists. So I could stop today and be a quite happy person, knowing that I've accomplished a lot in this business, and I can feel good about everything we've ever built, but I'm not done yet. So the future holds that I'll probably do more collaborative efforts, more design work with other companies. I'm off in new directions these days. I'm designing actually two amps right now, which are still a little ways away from release, but they're totally clean and they're just big brutish power amps, and they're going to be platforms for boutique pedals.
For me though, I have to always focus on where I want the company to go, and where we're moving, I think, is in two areas. We're working on giving you more useful products and more things that are in the higher end of the spectrum, so that you have more choices and more availability of true high-end product. Because as a lot of these companies fall off the market, we need to be up with the current trends and up with the current sounds and providing the high-end product that fits that. As well, we want to expand the company, and I think one of the ways of doing that is we do have to work on lower cost product that is more available to the working musician. And I guess last for me would be, I'm interested in doing more of the collaborative type products and learning from other people and having them learn from us and come up with new and interesting things, new approaches to things that people are ignoring in today's market. So those are, I think, the big areas where Diamond is headed. That's the problem that we're in. You know, if I gave advice to guys that like tube products, I would tell them, go out and buy the amplifier that you want now, because the more the tube supply dwindles, the more the supply of tube amplifiers will dwindle, right?
Correct.
So if you like tube products, get the tube amplifier that you're looking at now and get it a good one that's going to last you, because there may come a time where it's going to be difficult to even get a tube amplifier, let alone the tube supply to keep it running.
The moment that I really thought I had something was when I developed the circuit that is the key of the Soldano overdrive sound. And it's something that at one time I was in the process of trademarking, but I never followed it through to its end. But I called it controlled clipping with K's. It was a very cheesy 80s thing to do, you know, K's instead of C's. But it was a truly unique circuit that is what really sets the sound of a Soldano amp from anything else. It's a voicing. And that was probably my biggest moment, singular moment in the history of my tinkering with amps and of my company. My influences were more about how amps were constructed. In other words, sound-wise, there wasn't really anything out there that I was incredibly excited about, and that's what drove me to design what I designed, because I had a sound in my head I was hearing, couldn't get it, so I figured, well, I got to do this myself. You know, the old necessity, mother of invention kind of
thing.
Right,
right.
But the amps that impressed me the most were early high watts, just for the beauty of the wiring. I mean, I'm not really a turret board kind of guy in my own construction.
They were really pretty, though.
But they were pretty. You open one of those up and you look at them, and all that nice solid core wire that was neatly bundled and bent at 90 degrees and perfectly soldered, and just the layout and the placement of the parts, it was artwork. And so I love those early high watts.
Outside, it was supremely disappointed in the way everything looked for decades. It just,
yes.
To me, it was like, And there's no style element in it. You know, I liked, another thing I liked about the SLO was the use of the metal grate.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you know, we did that in a different way moving mm-hmm. forward. Some other people have done the same thing.
You know,
using Kettner used to do it. Some people have heard me say this before, but you know, where I drew a lot of inspiration for my early products was the GMC 3500 dualies. The trucks.
Right, you told me that once when we were talking on the
did
phone.
I?
Yeah. About the grill.
The grills,
yeah.
and the rugged nature.
The toughness.
It's an elegant looking thing, but it speaks as to rugged and durability.
Tough, yeah.
And that's where a lot of the aesthetic design came from in the first number of our products. It's frustrating sometimes to hear, well, you know, so-and-so's single cut is $79 cheaper.
Yeah, well, okay, there you go.
So-and-so single cut doesn't have a coil tap, and it doesn't have Seymour Duncan pickups in it, and it doesn't have a maple top on it. And, you know, we just got to remember there's more there. But in the end of the day, where we go from here is really, the nice part about it is a consumer-driven decision. Like the power of the popular vote, the guitar players have the ability to shape where we go.
Of course.
Right? We want to go to price. We're going to end up in Walmart. We want to go to quality. We're going to keep the cool guitar shops.
Yep.
That's where really where it comes down to.
Oh, amen. I agree.
Walmart or cool shop? Up to you.
That's right.
Yeah. The red light has to be out.
Yeah, that's the...
That's what that thing is?
I'm glad that's on tape.
It's like the... it's like the Simpsons episode. That light, sir, definitely indicates that it is not on. What does it do? You should ask what you can do for it.